Today we will be talking about open access to publication, specifically for Horizon 2020 project. This is an open air webinar. Tomorrow there will be another one on open access to research data. So let's start. Where did it all start with the EC and open access? It started with the FP7 project, where there was a pilot for seven areas in the framework which were requested to make their publication open access. This was a success, and in Horizon 2020, open access became the default option for all projects, for all peer-reviewed publications stemming from the results of their projects. So you will find all the information in your grant agreement, but why did the European Commission promote open access and open science? There are some very good reasons for that. First of all, it's good for science. Science should be transparent, and open access to publication means that scientists can access publications sooner and more easily, so they can build on previous results without unnecessary duplication of efforts. Also remember that subscriptions are often very expensive, and not all libraries and universities have the means to pay for all subscription. So open access to publication helps with the quality and the efficiency of research. It's also good for the economy. It can speed up innovation. Businesses, KMOs can easily find scientific publication, and they can adapt their businesses to the findings, and so the market can progress. It's good for society. Remember that Horizon 2020 is European money, so it's taxpayers' money, and so research paid by the people should be visible to the people. Think about citizens, but also, for example, citizen science, people who like to do their own experiments can now access publication more easily. Also, policy can access publication and adapt their policy to findings. So all in all, it's good for society, economy, and for science. So there are very good reasons that the EC is promoting open science and open access for publications. So in your grant agreement, if you're part of an Horizon 2020 project, it states that you have to ensure open access to peer-reviewed publications as soon as possible and at the latest on publication. You should deposit a machine-readable electronic copy of the published version or final peer-reviewed manuscript accepted for publication in a repository for scientific publication, together with bibliographic metadata providing the name of the action, acronym, and grant number. Now, this does sound a little bit complicated, and it surely is some jargon. So in today's webinar, we will see how you can easily provide open access to your publication and make sure that you're in line with all the requirements of the EC. Afterwards, I will talk a little bit about open air and what we do and why we do this webinar. But let's start with open access. How to make your publication open access? One of the misconceptions about open access publication is that the only way to do it is to publish in an open access journal. This is not the case. There are two non-exclusive ways to make publications open access. You can, of course, choose for an open access journal, but a traditional subscription-based journal, a closed journal, is also fine. In the first case, with a subscription-based traditional journal, you need to deposit a version of your publication in a repository and provide access to the repository. But also, if you publish in an open access journal, you should deposit in a repository and provide access. Why, may you ask? You already provided access to the open access journal. It's because repositories are very good at archiving, and it's a sustainable way of providing access to your publication. So even if something happens to the open access journal, it will still be searchable by search engines and will be easy to find. So you should always deposit a version in a repository and then add information, metadata. This is data about your publication, and you should definitely include the funder, so the EC, and your grant ID number or acronym, so your publication can be linked to your project. So which way to choose, a subscription-based journal and depositing in a repository or an open access journal? Well, both have their pros and cons. If you self-archive, which means subscription-based, and then deposit a version in a repository, you can choose from any subscription-based journal, so the journals you already know, and there are no fees included for the author. Of course, there's a subscription to pay, but most of the time this is paid by your library or your institutions, but there are no fees for the researchers. A con is that sometimes publishers put up an embargo to protect your exclusive rights to the publication. They will ask you to wait to provide open access to your publication through a repository. If you go for an open access journal, of course you have direct open access, so there's no embargo involved. And in some cases you can retain your copyrights. In the case of subscription-based journal, most of the time you sign over your copyright to the publisher. In open access journal, this is sometimes the case, but not always. There's a con, because open access journals do not have an income from subscription, they sometimes, not always, ask authors to pay for the publication costs. So there are possible costs involved in open access publishing. So I'll first talk about the open access journals, how to find one, and then I'll talk about depositing. So open access journals. There are a lot of open access journals, some of them very new, some of them established. If you do not know where to start looking for an open access journal in your field of study, you can consult the directory of open access journal. It's a list with high quality and peer-reviewed open access journals. You can look by subject or anything else. You can also find there information about article process charges, this publication fee that I talked about that open access journals sometimes require from their authors. So what about these article processes charges? How do you pay for them? Well, they are supported by Horizon 2020. For open access journals, but also for subscription-based journals that offer the possibility of making your individual article open access. These are called hybrid journals. They're traditional journals with a subscription, but they also allow certain articles to be open access. This is sometimes debated because, of course, they have income from both sources, both from article processes charges and from subscriptions, but the EC for now doesn't make any distinction between those two types of open access publishing. But there's a but. These costs are eligible for reimbursement, but only during the duration of the action. And as most researchers know, publication often only appear after the project is finished, because the peer review takes some time or because there's still some writing up to do. So how do you budget for these article process charges? You can take the average APC, multiple it's by the number of publication you plan to publish. These costs are part of the dissemination costs, but APCs vary widely. So it is sometimes difficult to know what to budget for APCs. You can look for specific journals. Sometimes they have information on their publisher's website. You can ask librarians if they have any information, or you can base your average on the average APC. But even then, average APCs are hard to estimate because they can vary widely. I looked up some information on that. The 1,400 euros are numbers from 2012, and the almost 2,000 as an average of APC is a number from 2016. As you can see, APCs are on the rise. It's a new model, so publishers are still figuring out what they can ask and what the cost is. So there is a distinction between open access journals and hybrid journals, so journals that ask for a subscription. Hybrid journals are on average more expensive. But it depends on the type of journal publisher and the fields you're publishing. So if you want more information on APCs, there's a very good project called Open APCs, where you can find information per publisher and journal, and they try to make the APC model a bit more transparent, because at this moment it is sometimes hard to find out what it covers. So to conclude, both types of publication costs can be reimbursed in Horizon 2020, and as of now there is no cap for APCs. Some issues to consider when you choose open access publishing or open access journal based on APCs. I have to say, not all open access journals ask for APCs, so there are definitely journals out there who do not ask their authors to pay a fee. But they have other business models, they get funding, for example. But publishing all articles in APC-based open access journal is probably expensive, and you have to consider what amount of the project budget you want to spend on APCs. So a mix of depositing articles and publishing in open access journal is recommended. Another issue to consider is the open access journal is market is growing, and there are some questionable journals out there, people that think it's easy money but don't do any quality or do not have a quality peer review process in place. So use your common sense, look at the website, look at a peer review process, and consult a whitelist such as doha.org. So if you publish in an open access journal or a subscription-based journal, you should always deposit a version in a repository. A repository is an archive for research publication. So where can you find one? Most institutions, big institutions such as university or research centers, have their own repository. There are some disciplinary repositories such as Europe PubMed Central. You also have Synodo, which is an EC co-founded repository, not only for publication, but also for data, that accepts publication also not only for EC-funded project, but all scientific outputs. If you do not know where to start looking for a repository, there are some directories for open access repository as well, with information on disciplines and countries, stuff like that. Open Door, WAR, ePrints, and Open Air has a list of Open Air compliant repositories. And I'll explain what an Open Air compliant repository is and why it is useful later in the slides. What to deposit? It should be a peer-reviewed version, so not a preprint. And this can be the published version. This is often not allowed by publisher, or the final peer-reviewed manuscripts. Then you can add metadata, funder, quant ID number, acronym, publication date, things like that. The open access requirements of the EC apply to all kinds of publications, so also monographs, book chapters, and also grey literature, such as conference papers. But the emphasis is on peer-reviewed journal articles. When to deposit, this is also an easy one, as soon as possible, and at the latest on publication. This is when to deposit. So first you deposit, and then you can provide open access. You can either do this immediately if you have published in an open access journal. This is not a problem. If you published in a subscription-based journal, there's sometimes an embargo. So the EC allows an embargo of 6 months before providing open access, and 12 months in case of social science and humanities. Now, some publishers have an embargo that is longer than 6 months. And the EC provides a model amendment to publisher agreements. So the publisher agreements which you sign with your publisher, you can ask to change it to be in line with the policy of the EC. So they have an example which you can use. It's not mandatory, but it has all the elements that make your publication in line with the EC requirements. The slides will be available, so the link is there. What can I deposit? Is this legal, just uploading my publication in a repository? Yes, but as said before, publishers sometimes limit what version you can upload. You can check policy on what version you can upload and if there's an embargo on the publisher's website most of the time, but you can also consult Sherpa Romeo, which gives an overview of copyright policies and self-archiving permission. These are the different versions that you're often allowed to upload. You have the pre-print, before peer review, post-print, publisher version. This is the one with the layout and all the images. And you can find embargo periods. So the one that are peer reviewed are the one that the EC asks you to upload in a repository. When you look at the policies, you should, in Sherpa Romeo, look for the green and the blue one. These are the peer-reviewed versions. So in short, as researchers, if you're part of a Horizon 2020 project, first of all, you can decide where to publish. This can either be an open access journal. If you want to check the quality of an open access journal or are looking for one, you can consult DORJ, or you can use a subscription-based journal to publish your articles. Both ways are fine. You should, however, always self-archive in a repository to know what you're allowed to do, check the publisher policies on possible embargoes and possible limits to versions on Sherpa Romeo. It's a really good website for that. If you choose for an open access journal, keep in mind that sometimes they will ask for an article process charge from the author. Make sure you have budget for that. In case of open access publishing, you can provide immediately open access in a repository. For a subscription-based journal, sometimes that's allowed too, and sometimes there's an embargo. Make sure that the embargo is not longer than 6 months or 12 months for social science. So all in all, this is it. This is what you need to do to make your publications open access. So Horizon 2020 started with not only open access to publications, but also open access to data. There's an open research data pilot, and some projects are involved in this as well. So what about research data? I will talk about that tomorrow. There's another webinar. Maybe somebody can post a link, but if you go to openair.eu under events, you will surely find it. So if you want to know more about data, tomorrow, same time, and hopefully we will have less problems with putting the presentation online. So I wanted to talk about OpenAir. This webinar is hosted by OpenAir, and OpenAir is an EC-funded project as well. So we're not a commercial player or anything. What OpenAir is it's both an infrastructure and it's also a network of people. They provide information and access to research outputs, and they facilitate the open access policy of the European Commission. So they are an infrastructure. They want to connect the dots. Imagine you're a big European project with people in different countries depositing in different repositories. How to make sure that your project and all your publications are compliant with the EC demands for open access publication? Well, that's where OpenAir can help and tries to help with its infrastructure. The aim is to only have to deposit once, so you can deposit your publication in your local repository, And OpenAI works together with repositories, with data archives, with open access journals, and gathers information on publication, their access level, and which projects they are part of. Because we have all this information and we gather it in one place and deduplicate it and clean it, we can build, OpenAI can build services, services on top of it to simplify Horizon 2020 reporting. So this is why open air compliant repositories come in handy. We work together with more than 1,000 data providers. These are also open access journals and repositories. And those data providers provide us with information so we can gather all the information from all the different data providers in one place. You can look up if your repository is part of the open air network. For example, Ghent University, the university I'm part of, is open air compliant. Or if you do not find a repository that's open air compliant, you can use Zenodo. I talked about Zenodo before as the EC funded repository, and I'll shortly explain what it is. Zenodo is what we call a catch-all repository. That means it's not part of an institution, it's not part of any discipline. All research outputs and data is welcome in Zenodo. So it's also not only publications, also reports, data sets, even software is welcome. So you can all upload it and share it on Zenodo. Things that are uploaded in Zenodo get a DIY. This is a digital object identifier, a unique code attached to your publication or your data, which makes it easy and uniquely citable. In Zenodo, you can also start a community. So if you're a project with different partners, you can have one place for all your publications or all your data sets, even video or audio from conferences you did, uploaded and saved in one place. It's in line with reporting for the European Commission, so it's in line with funding. Information that is in Zenodo will be transferred to DEC, to OpenAI. There's a flexible licensing system. Zenodo is very much in favor of open access publishing, open access depositing, but it's not the only option. It's very safe, it makes use of the CERN infrastructure, and there are multiple copies of Zenodo elsewhere. And it has a GitHub integration for software and a Dropbox integration, so it makes it easy to upload, describe, and publish. When you upload in Zenodo, you can just choose a file or use Dropbox, and then you can describe. So this is the metadata I talked about before. So definitely make sure you add your funder, DEC, or any other funder, and your project. You can upload all types of files, and you can choose your access level. Here you can see that you can also go for an embargoed access. So if your publisher sets an embargo, you can put the embargo date in Zenodo and you do not have to worry about it anymore. It will become available after the embargo is finished. Then you can just publish or upload, and it will show your article if there's no embargo. It will show article level metrics, which show you the amount that your article is shared and viewed. It's citable with this unique code, DOI, and there's a link with the funding information. So this is Zenodo, zenodo.org. If you're looking for a repository or a data repository, it's really easy to use, and it's in line with all the requirements of DEC. So OpenAI has different services. As said before, we're an infrastructure, so we work with data providers, but also with funders. We started with the EC, but there are more and more funders interested in our services to track if the open access requirements are being followed. And we have services for researchers and research administrations, which is what I'm going to talk about now, because I think most of you are either researchers or project coordinators. So what can OpenAI do? Because we have this information from different repositories and from different places, open access journals, but also funder information, we integrate all this information in one place. So all the publications and data and funder information are in one place, and we then build services on top of that, which can help you with reporting, generating publication lists, and disseminating your projects. Reporting, every European project has a project base page with publication. So OpenAI is not a repository. We get this information from other repositories and link it to your project page. There's also an automatically communication between the EC project portal, CORDIS, and the participants portal for reporting. You can generate your publication list and you can disseminate your projects by embedding information in your website or using the information and statistics provided by OpenAI. This is our website. If you want to look at your project page, you can find it on the publication data project by search. You can also find various other things if you're looking for other funders, for your organization, for example. You can find it on openair.au, that's a mistake, /search. This is an example of a project page. You can see the detailed information about the project there. There's a link to CORDIS. There's this appox, then the list of publications and data, if there's any data sets attached to your publication or to your project, and some statistics about what you publish and whether it's open access or not. So you can share this project page on our research communication website and social media. The appox, what I find interesting about it is that you can have an HTML code, which you can incorporate in your project website. That way you do not have to update your publication list every time you have a new publication, but can it will be automated, like you see here an example of it. Your list of publication, this is collected from our data providers, and you can also look at some statistics, see what year publication are added to repositories, and how much percentage of your publications are open access. If you click on one of the articles, there's also some information here, like how much has been tweeted, and references, related data, and similar publications. So it's a lot of information about your project in one place, which would otherwise be spread across different repositories or different journals. So what if sometime something is missing? What if you do not find a publication that is part of your project? Well, you can use our services, our linking service, to associate your research results so it will still appear on OpenAI and also in the participants portal of the EC. So there's an automatic list generated of your publications in CORDIS. This is the front end of the European project. As you can see, this is still the old logo, but all the publications listed there are provided through OpenAI because we harvest information from repositories. And very interesting, this list will also be sent to the back end of reporting, the participants portal for reporting. So if you have to report your publications and they're in OpenAI compliant repositories, they will already be there. So the only thing you have to do is check the reference and if the publication is indeed part of your project. And if it's not, you can delete it. If it's all in order, you can just use this list. So it makes reporting a lot more easy. So this is a quick overview. OpenAIR provides open access depositing and storing of research data through Zenodo. That's the Zenodo.org. You can claim publication and data sets that are missing in OpenAIR. It helps you report your research output by linking your research outputs to the EC portal or using our appbox for compiling a report. It can help you monitor if all publications are open access and help you discover and access other publications. So this is part of the infrastructure. Now, behind OpenAIR is also a big network of people that provide information on open science in general. So not only open access but to publication, but also open access to journal or, for example, open peer review. There's a lot of information and material that can help you on the open access website. We have guides and fact sheets. Fact sheets are short and to the point guides that can help you with EC policy on open access. We do workshops in every country. So in the coming 3 years, there should be an OpenAIR workshop somewhere near you. We do webinars like this one. We have a help desk system and frequently asked questions. So behind the help desk system are our regional experts, our NOAs, National Open Access Desk. We have one in every European country and beyond, also Turkey, Switzerland, Norway, for example. And they cannot only support you with EC related questions, but also anything related to open science on a national level. If you would be interested in, for example, policy or information on open access in your country, there are also country pages for every country involved in OpenAIR with local information on open science. And that's it for me. I do not see the chat, so I'm going to close my presentation. Thank you for attending. And if there are any questions, I will answer it, or Gwen will help. Okay, I'm closing the presentation. Thank you. Oh, thank you, Irina, for putting all the links there.
Okay, so hi, Emily. We're going to maximize the chat window so that people have any questions, they can just type it in there, and maybe you can.
I do not hear Gwen.
Oh, I'm sorry. People can type, if you have any questions, please type them in the chat box. Annie, where is it gone? I don't see the chat box anymore.
Sorry, Gwen, I didn't hear you. I didn't see any questions. The slide will be shared as well as the recording. Okay, if there's any questions, let me know. And otherwise, have a very nice afternoon. I hope the sun's shining there as well.
Okay, thank you very much, Emily. Again, oh, there is a question.
If a paper is in the humanities but published in a non-humanities journal, what is the embargo? Can you answer that, Gwen?
Yes, I think embargoes, Irina, feel free to chip in if you disagree, but embargoes are journal or publisher related, not related to the topic of the paper. So, to the topic, but I think what you mean is that because of the conditions that the European Commission allows, so they allow a six a 12-month embargo for.
So that would make it 6 months then.
Allows. I'm sorry, I'm typing at the same time, so that's Emily. I'm not aware of any that of the, if the Commission keeps any lists of like certified humanities journals. So I think you can be pretty confident that if your work is in humanities, and even if the paper appears in a non-humanities journal, in a general open access journal, I think you can be confident that you are in compliance with the rule. Yeah, exactly. That's what Irina says as well. So I hope that answers your questions. Yeah. Okay, so if there are no more other questions, I would like again to apologize for the technical issues at the beginning of the webinar. Apparently there was something wrong with the fonts of the presentation and our system did not recognize them. So we'll try to have this solved for tomorrow when Emily, at exactly the same time and in the same room, will talk about the open data policies and requirements in Horizon 2020. So we'll hope to see you then again. And as for this webinar, I've already pasted the link to the slide deck, so it's on our SlideShare group, and we will distribute the recordings of this webinar as soon as it's available. So thank you very much for attending. I see one more person is asking. Okay, thank you very much. We will also send you an evaluation form about this webinar. We do realize we had some technical issues, but we would really appreciate if you could give us some feedback about the content. We will send this evaluation form together with the recordings and the slides. See you tomorrow.